endures forever. Sing praise. Outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise.
I depend on you. to you again and again.
You are my rock in times of trouble.
You are my rock in times of trouble. You lift me up when I fall down. All through the storm, your love.
above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Yeah, forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. Outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise.
Welcome to Stevens Road Baptist Church. We're so glad that you chose to join us today. Whether you are watching Sunday morning or another time during the week through YouTube, on our Facebook premiere, and jotting a hello in our comments or an FM service, we're just thrilled that you are with us. And if you are watching on Facebook Premiere, be sure to take a minute and say hello in the comments. Myself or someone will respond to you when we're on there, myself or Pastor Christopher. I just would love to hear from you and how you are doing. We just found out that we are have another 2 weeks extended on our circuit breaker lockdown, whatever you choose to call it, staying close to home. And so it will definitely probably be later June by the time we see you in person. So until then, we're just going to be here online and see you that way and connect that way. Well, we are doing a series called right now called Running Unburdened, and Pastor Christopher and I have been showcasing our run shirts that we have gotten from the various runs that we completed. And in 2019 was a summer where I did a number of runs and had the privilege to do the Windsor Fun Run, and actually was with Marcus, Pastor Christopher, and Megan. And we're all different types of runners, and we all have our different paces and speeds. And I did most of that run by myself, and it was a hard run. So this is the shirt you might have saw, Pastor Christopher, if you're keen. It might look a little familiar to you. And that run was difficult for me. I remember halfway through thinking it was only a 5 kilometer run, and I remember halfway through, for whatever reason, I just wanted to walk the rest of the way, wanted to give up, but I was like, no, like, you can do this. Had to give myself a pep talk to get through that, and was almost like about to start to cry. I don't know what it was. Sometimes these things can be emotional as you go through, and that's like our journey, our faith journey. As we're following Jesus, we can definitely be going through our struggles and definitely be filled with emotions, and we just have to take those to Jesus when they come along. Have you ever been doing something and you just think, I can't do this anymore? Maybe it was, who knows, whatever that was. It could have been something like, maybe you tried a new recipe and it didn't work out. Maybe it was something a little more difficult than that, or maybe it's a new job or whatever that is. If you're willing to share in the comments, I'd love to hear. If you want to talk about it, then you can send us a message. Well, we have a few things to update you on, and one of those things was that we still will be online for another few weeks, and probably, as I said, won't be until the end of June that we might be able to get back here in person. We have hired Matthew Croft. Most of you would know him. He is a student at UMB, but also has been part of our church family his entire life. And so we're super excited to welcome him to our summer team for the next 15 weeks. And he'll be taking over our kind of communications, social media, that kind of that department. And so those weekly emails that you get, he's going to start doing those for us. He'll be editing these digital church service videos for us, and he'll be managing our social media accounts and helping us to get ready so that in the fall, hopefully, we can move to live streaming. And so we're just super excited to have you, Matthew, with us. And he may even be in the comments in there saying hello. So be sure that you welcome Matthew if you're watching on Facebook Premiere today. The other is that we will have chit chat after the service today at 11:30 on Zoom. If you need that info, just send us a message or an email and we'll make sure you get that. But it's always in our weekly email that we send out, typically on Fridays. And May Missions, we have raised enough money that the raised garden beds at the community center are taken care of. And so the rest of the funds that come in will be going to Briny House. And that is a place where women can go, women and their children who've been part of abusive relationships, and they go there for help and can get, there's all kinds of programs and things there. And so we're excited to be able to partner with them, Briny House here in Dartmouth. So if you want to give to our May Missions project, then you can always do an e-transfer just in the memo. Just put that it's for May Missions. Please include your name. If you've never given before, just send an email to us with your name and address so we can get you a tax receipt for that and be able to send it to you. And You can always send in a check, or we do have a mail slot on the side of the church near the office doors that you could place an envelope in there as well. We just want to thank you so much for giving to our May missions projects this month. And we also want to say thank you to those who continually support the church and our ministries through your weekly, monthly, occasional giving, however that is, just to our general ministry. So we thank you so much for that. We have 2 weeks of Ask Our Kids Better Than Gold left, and so today and next week, and we're hoping that we can have a pirate party because it is a pirate theme right now, and so we're thinking that's going to be now the end of June, the first week of July, where we can kind of end this season, but also kind of kick off summer ministry and have our summer students in place then. And so we're looking forward to that. We'll be in the parking lot, and we're really hoping that we'll be able to see our kids in person for our pirate party. I think that is all besides our regular things like Bible study on Tuesday morning on Zoom at 10 o'clock. Youth group this week. We had youth group on Friday for one con. Maybe some of you went on and watched the live stream. So there will be none Sunday evening. And we will be back for youth group online next week. All right. Let's take a moment and pray together. Just to let you know, Clark is recovering well at home and seems to be doing great in his recovery. But please continue to pray for him that recovery goes well. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for another day. Thank you that we can join together here online to hear your word, to hear a message that you've put on Pastor Christopher's heart. And would you just help us to focus and to hear what you would have to say to us as individuals, but to us as a body of believers as well. God, I pray that you'd be with those who are really struggling right now, especially with the lockdown and not being able to see others in person, who are just struggling emotionally and mentally, maybe even physically, not feeling they can really get out or go for drives very far. For those who are having a hard time this season, would you lift them up, bring them encouragement, and would you help us to encourage each other during this time as we wait and to encourage each other to do our part so that we will be able to have some good time in the summer, that maybe we will be able to have our household bubble back and be able to see a few more people. So be with us, and we thank you for Dr. Strang and Ian Rankin, and be with them and all those on their teams who are working tirelessly to manage everything that goes around with COVID-19 and testing and vaccinations and reports and everything else, Lord. It must be exhausting. And so we just ask that you be with them as well, help them to find the rest they need so that they can be there for this province, for the people, Lord. And as we watch press conferences and as we hear what they're telling us, may we choose our words wisely as we may make comments online or to other people about what's being said. May we be the light that you have called us to be in those situations, Lord. God, be with us now and go with us throughout the rest of this day and this week. We thank you for being with us and for watching over us. In your name we pray, amen. I'm going to pass it over to Pastor Christopher now, and remember, you can stick around for SR Kids Church.
Good morning and welcome. I am so glad that you're here with us as we have been working on our series, Running Unburdened. I've been curious about something lately. Every now and again, I'll hear a story about an artist or a celebrity or an athlete where they're selling off a piece of memorabilia, an award or some sort of honor that they've been given. A couple of weeks ago, I was listening to a podcast called Secretly Incredibly Fascinating. Super fun podcast if you are like me and just like to learn random things that you can bring up in conversation from time to time. And it was all about keys. And in particular, they were talking about an antidote about Cher being given a key to the city, an Australian city of Adelaide. In 2012, kind of a minor controversy surfaced because the key that Cher had been given ended up on eBay. She was selling it, only it wasn't her selling it. She, of course, came out and made a statement of how grateful she was and how treasured it was. It seems like somehow one of her cousins had gotten a hold of the key, and they opted to put it on Facebook or on eBay and sell it. And it reminded me of a story that came up in the early 2000s, I think 2004 maybe. And if you are a science fiction and fantasy fan, about the same vintage as I am, maybe plus or minus a couple of years, maybe you will remember, again, a minor controversy here in Canada when a certain platinum-haired actor named James Marsters had earned a Spacey Award for his betrayal as Spike. His award also ended up on eBay, being sold, and he claimed a personal trainer of his had stolen it. Now, generally, when I was looking this up, generally it seems like it is these sort of kind of minor awards or accolades that end up for sale, but it really did get me thinking. I was curious, like, what about the big ones? You know, what about the Oscars or the Grammys or the Tonys? You know, if I had a lot of extra money laying around, like, could I net myself a Best Actor award? The short answer is no. The Oscars and the Tonys both have clauses in their agreements that if you're given one of these awards and for whatever reason you want to get rid of it, you know, your shelf is too full of them or whatever it is, you want to sell them, you have to go back to the... If you have an Oscar you want to sell, you have to go back to the Oscars first and offer to sell it to them. And if you want to sell it, the Oscars is willing to buy your statue for a grand total of $1. And they have the first right of refusal. If you try to sell it to anybody else, the crack legal team of the Oscars, the Academy Awards, will swoop in and deal with it. The Tonys is 10 times as generous. If you want to get rid of your Tony Award, if you want to try to sell it, you have to sell it back to them first, but they are willing to buy that award for $10. Very generous of them. Grammys are a little easier to come by. I mean, in the sense that they're almost never sold, so they go for a fair amount of money. Sports memorabilia, championship rings for the NHL, the NFL, those sorts of things. They come up on sale every now and again, usually because the athlete has come down on some hard times and needs a little bit of cash. But what if I wanted like the big awards? Like the big athletic awards? Because, you know, an NHL ring would be cool, but it's not like I can buy the Stanley Cup. I mean, if I really wanted the big award for athletics, we're probably talking Olympic medals, right? I mean, I'm never going to earn an Olympic gold medal. I'm both not skilled enough and considerably too old to try to earn anything for the Olympics. I mean, maybe Olympic speed walking. But What if I just wanted to buy an Olympic medal? Could I? Are the athletes able to sell them? Again, the short answer to that is yes. Athletes are able to sell their Olympic medals if they want. There is no International Oversight Community or Committee for the Olympics does not prevent that. It is, however, exceedingly rare for these medals to be sold. And when they are, they're almost always for noble or tragic reasons. For example, Mark Wells, he was part of the U.S.'s 1980s gold-winning hockey team. He sold his medal back in 2010. It went for a little more than $300,000, and he needed it to pay for his medical bills. He developed a rare spinal condition. Prior to it going on for auction, he wrote that he wore it night and day for 14 weeks because he treasured it so much. But being an Olympic athlete is not exactly a lucrative job, and he needed the money. Another example is Waldemar Klitschko. I know I said that wrong. He is a Ukrainian boxer. He earned a gold medal in 1996 for boxing. It was the first time that Ukraine got to participate in the Olympics as an independent country. He auctioned off his medal for $1 million, and he used it to raise money for a foundation that supported kids getting involved in sport. The neat part of that story is the person who won the auction actually donated the medal back to him. There are a couple of other examples that I found, but they're all basically the same thing. Either the athlete is donating their medal to raise money for charity, or the athlete has large medical bills that they need to pay. And that made sense to me. These awards are treasured. They're clearly difficult to earn, and they're loved by the people who have them. They are not easily parted with. Olympians train for years just for a chance to go to the Olympics. And then most people, they come home empty-handed. I mean, I know the medals that I've earned, the ones for the fun races that I've participated in or the Taekwondo tournaments that I've been a part of. I mean, they are considerably less prestigious and much, much easier to earn. But I treasure them. You know, we display them in our home with pride that we earned these. And that's actually what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about the types of prizes that you and me, as Christ followers, that we are working towards. Paul talks about two prizes that as followers of Christ that we're seeking to earn. I'm going to read two short passages, one from 1 Corinthians and one from 1 Thessalonians, and they're both about striving towards a prize. So 1 Corinthians 9, 24 to 27. Do you not know that in a race, all runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, do not run like someone running aimlessly. Do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. So that was the Corinthians passage. Let's look at the Thessalonians passage. 1 Thessalonians 2, 17 to 20. But brothers and sisters, when we were orphaned by being separated from you for a short time, in person, not in thought, out of our intense longing, we made every effort to see you. for he wanted to come back to you. Certainly I, Paul, did again and again, but Satan blocked our way. For what is our hope, our joy, our crown, in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord when he comes? Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and our joy. So I think these two ideas come together in a really lovely way. But let's go through them kind of one at a time first. Let's look at the Corinthians passage. Now, from sometime in the 6th century BC, just outside of Corinth, there has been a high-level competitive games held every 2 years called the Isthmian Games. They are held in the spring prior to the Olympics, and then 2 years again later. These games had foot races, boxing, wrestling, I think you would call it pancreton. It's a type of mixed martial arts. It's about strikes and kicks and locks. It's like the ancient world version of MMA. There's not a lot of rules, and I imagine people get pretty hurt doing it. And of course, chariot races. Along with these athletic contests, there also were musical and poetry contests as well. The sports were open only to men, but the poetry and the music contests were open to both men and women. These games were held in honor of the god Poseidon, the Greek god of the sea. And these games were still well active while Paul was writing. And they would be active for many years, for a couple of centuries after him. These games were not considered a run-up to the Olympics. They were considered a rival to the Olympics. And these games were important to the culture as a whole. In fact, so important, centuries before Paul, before Roman rule descended over the Greek area, when Greek cities operated more as independent city nations, city states, as opposed to a unified country, when Corinth went to war with Athens, it came time for these games to be played. And as the games approached, the war did not end, but Athens and Corinth took a temporary truce, a ceasefire, for the month leading up to and a number of months into the games. Not only was there a ceasefire, but the Athenian athletes were allowed to travel into Corinth to participate in these games. These are important. They're a cultural legacy. Just to make sure you get a sense of how big these games and how seriously they were taken, athletes would typically arrive about a month early so they could not just train, but train on the track or in the ring so they were going to have to compete. These training sessions could be watched by anyone who lived in the city. And while the Isthmian Games, didn't reach to the same kind of long-lasting legacy as the Olympic Games, as we still are participating in the Olympics now, they definitely were a bunch of Olympic hopefuls. I mean, maybe we could understand them as the various world or international championships that we host now every few years. The crowds may have been a bit smaller, but the talent was no less spectacular. So when Paul wants to talk about having a disciplined life, striving towards a goal, he points the Corinthians, this group of Greek followers of Jesus, to the games that they have been watching their entire life. It's as if he says, look at how they're training. Look at the time and dedication that they dedicate to their sport. Look at their skill. Look at their strength. Look at their speed. Look at their endurance. And then look at the prize that they're trying to earn. See, the prize that Paul is talking about, the crown that they get for winning any of these particular games, traditionally, it was made out of stalks of celery. In Paul's day, it was more likely made out of pine branches and leaves. Either way, the prize that Paul is saying that these competitive elite athletes who are training for years on their own and for a solid month together, the prize that they're getting is flimsy. And sure, a carefully cared for laurel or dried wreath of leaves and sticks, I guess, can last. We have two wreaths like that in our house. They were made as kids' night out crafts a number of months ago. But I can't like touch them and move them around very much. We found a place to keep them, and sort of there they stay for risk of kind of their stuff kind of breaking off and crumbling. I mean, I suspect most of these athletes who won in these games, the journey back home would have been more than enough for their prize to be deteriorated or destroyed. And that's the contrast that Paul wants to pull out. Look at so much time, so much dedication, so much discipline. And for what? A temporary prize that likely doesn't even last the trip home. See, that's the point that Paul wants the Corinthians to begin to ponder. And it's that contrast that I think that we need to think about as well. Are we putting our time, our energy into things that will last or into things that are temporary? Because whatever you are, or wherever you are right now, whether you are out and about in your car, whether you are sitting in your house, whether you are listening to this on a podcast while you're out and about, there are things that are around you that are temporary and things that are around you that are eternal. The temporary stuff is pretty easy to identify, though we sometimes forget about it. The clothing that we are wearing will all need to be replaced at some point. The food in our cupboards is either going to be eaten or it's going to rot. The house that we are living in, it won't last forever. I mean, it might last for a long time, especially if you maintain it or I maintain mine, but it's not going to be there forever. The job that you're doing right now isn't forever. The hobby that you love right now, it's not going to be forever. The stage of life that you're in, whether it's young kids or no kids or empty nest or nest or newlyweds, maybe you're celebrating 50 years of marriage together. Maybe you are celebrating a whole life of singlehood. It doesn't matter. Whatever it is, it's not forever. But you yourself, and the yous around you, that I suspect is different. As are all of the other people you've ever met and have ever encountered. See, you have an eternal future, an eternal destiny. And Paul, and I guess now me, we're saying that you want to make sure that you are committing, that you're committed to moving towards that prize. Or more on point, Paul says, therefore, I do not run like somebody running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body, and I make it my slave, so that after I preach to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. See, Paul's point is he is self-disciplined. He has considered what he has done before. He is considering what he has done before, what he's doing now, and he makes sure that whatever it is that he is doing, it either adds to his race, or at the very least, it doesn't detract from it. See, Paul is saying that he is trying to make sure all of his actions, that his life reflects his belief and his words. Because it's pretty easy to say God is love, or you should treat others the way they want to be treated, or you should treat others as Christ has treated us. But when the rubber really hits the road, doing it is hard. Because we all have a bit of a me first streak in us, don't we? Or a my people first streak in us. But we're not running a me first race. That's not the prize that we're trying to earn. That's the distraction that we're trying to push off. That's the little bit of selfishness in us that we're trying to train away, that we're trying to discipline down. But if you run aimlessly or you beat the air without purpose, that's probably what's going to happen. You'll land in a me first, me second, and I'll help whoever else with whatever else I have left. There just tends not to be very much left if that's the way that we approach life. And that brings us to the second prize. And because I've been kind of prattling on for a little while, let me read that Thessalonians passage one more time to remind you of it. But brothers and sisters, when we were orphaned by you, when we were orphaned by being separated from you for a short while, not in person, not in thought, out of our intense longing, we made every effort to see you, for we wanted to come to you. Certainly I, Paul, did again and again, but Satan blocked our way. For what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes? Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and our joy. Thessalonica is a major port city and a major commerce city. And like most major cities, it also has a pretty impressive arena. A few decades after Paul writes this letter, it's going to get a pretty big upgrade, and it's going to become a major gladiatorial location. But from Paul's perspective, it doesn't quite have the same impressive facilities as Corinth does, but there are plenty of ways where you can kind of root for the home team. And here again, Paul talks about earning a crown. It's the same sort of laurel, the wreath that you would wear after an Olympic win or the games in Corinth. But he's not talking about that same self-discipline. He's talking about the one that he and his companions have earned. His companions are probably Timothy, who if you are reading Thessalonians, you'll bump into a little later, and his friend Silas, who we learn about in the book of Acts, had visited Thessalonica. And there are probably a handful of people who we just don't know their names, but were traveling with Paul at the time. Friends that stayed with him in the city. See, they had to leave the Thessalonica city because it risked a riot. Paul had been there for a long time, teaching in the synagogues, teaching in the community areas. A fledgling church was growing. And as these churches do, In Paul's time, we kind of had a negative impact on the economy. Christians didn't buy little silver idols anymore. We didn't buy meat sacrificed to idols for the most part. We had a funny impact on the community. And it stirred up tensions. And Paul had to leave for fear of violence. But when he left, he never stopped thinking about, praying about, and being excited about the people that he met in Thessalonica. And he wanted to go back multiple times. He just couldn't. He wasn't able to do it. But when he thought about these people, it brought him joy. So after he finally was able to get an update, a letter about how they were doing, he was thrilled. It gave him even more joy. He was so glad to hear how well they were doing. They were his crown. They were his gold medal that he wore around his metaphorical neck with deep pride. Their growth in their faith, the way they loved and cared for each other, the positive change that they were attempting to bring into their city, it was Paul's prize. So I have a question for you to think about. For us to ask ourselves, who are our prizes? Who are our crowns? Who are the people that we can beam about, feeling joy as we consider them? Here's the thing. Don't sell yourself short. my faith, the faith that I'm carrying around, it was passed to me ultimately by my parents and a lot of other people. And I took it up on my own. But their faith was passed to them by somebody else. Both of my grandmothers and one of my grandfathers were all deeply committed to their faith. And their faith was passed on to them, I think, probably by their parents. But I, in fairness, I don't know. I have no idea where it came from. And I don't know where the person who told them, like where their faith originated, you know, who helped pass it on to them. What I do know is this, is somewhere, somehow, there is a chain of faithful people passing on their faith, trying to love Christ, trying to love their neighbors and families as best as they understood it at the time, that reaches from me all the way back to Mary and Martha standing outside of a tomb when Jesus was raised from the dead for the first time. There's an unbroken line of transmission. Christianity has never disappeared from the face of the earth after that moment. And because time is quirky like this way, as I fast forward and think about the future, as I imagine the people that you can impact, even if it is just a small circle of people around you, your family and friends, the people who you are, in fairness, most likely to impact, as we move forward by generation and generation and generation, that sphere of influence, those people who, because you were faithful, they've come to be followers of Christ as well, will in fact grow exponentially, and I use that word in the literal sense. Or at least it could do that. These people may never know your name, but they will be your prize and your crown, and you can beam with pride for them. See, like I said, there are two kinds of things, the temporal and the eternal. And the actions that you take today as you seek to apply Jesus' teachings to your life, as you love the people around you, as you draw them closer to Jesus, even if it is only by tiny steps, they are becoming your joy, your hope, and your crown. So as a Christ follower, you then are called not to live your life aimlessly, but to live it on purpose. And like a lot of things in this life, that will begin in your heart and in your mind. The things that you believe will influence your thoughts. Your thoughts will influence your actions. Your actions are going to become your habits, and your habits will become your life. And a lot of us actually don't think very much about this process. We kind of operate on a cultural autopilot. But as a follower of Christ, you need to work to not fall into this autopilot mode. Instead, run your race with purpose and earn your lasting prize, a life well lived and other lives positively impacted. Let me offer you a prayer. Well, gracious God, we just thank you so much for today. We thank you for the race that you have put us on, and for the people that you have brought into our lives that we can positively impact and help draw nearer to your Son. May we move with integrity. May we move with purpose. May we move with selflessness. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. So if you're on YouTube, this is it. This is all I have for you. Same for our FM service, other than I'll pop in and say farewell. If you are here on Facebook, SR Kids Church is coming up. And please don't forget, at 11:30, we have 11:30 on Sunday morning, we have a chit-chat on Zoom. We'd love to see you there. Let me offer you a benediction. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. So go in peace. We'll see you next week. Same Baptist time, same Baptist channel.